two very quick statements at the first of the lesson. Number one, God has heard every one of them. They are only good for those that use them. And then thirdly, some have as many as Carter has little liver pills. If you're older, you know about those things. If you're younger, you probably don't. Every one of those statements are applying to exactly the same thing. Folks, what we are talking about are spiritual excuses. God's heard them all. They're only good for those that use them. And some individual have as many excuses as Carter has little liver pills. One question that we might ask is this: what is the definition of an excuse? And one definition is this: an explanation for being excused. Another definition of excuse is a plea to be released from an obligation. And a third one is this: a justification as to why something cannot be done. My friends, we are in 2017, and at the beginning of this year, we began a theme, did we not? And our theme for this year is this: I am resolved. And I promised you that at the first of each month, I would have at least one lesson based upon our theme for this year. And our lesson for today is very simply this: I am resolved to give up all of my excuses. Let's begin by noting that we do make excuses, don't we? In fact, we have a tendency in our spiritual lives to make excuses in all areas of our spiritual living. Let me give you a list of just a few. We have excuses as to why we cannot serve in the kingdom of God. We have excuses as to why we cannot attend the worship services on Sunday, Sunday night, and Wednesday. We have excuses for not studying the Bible. We have excuses for not praying. We have excuses for not evangelizing, that is, taking the gospel to those individuals who are lost in our world. We have excuses as to why we cannot give the way we really need to give. We give excuses as to why we do not fulfill our duties and our obligations toward one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. Individuals have all kinds of excuses as to why they refuse to submit to the authority of the elders of the church. Individuals have excuses for treating others badly. And here's an interesting one. Individuals give all kinds of excuses as to why they engage constantly in sin and transgression of God's will. Folks, we make excuses in all kinds of areas. Notice the kind of excuses that we like to make. One excuse has to do with work, does it not? Gotta work. If I hear that excuse given once, I've heard that excuse given a million times as to why people can or cannot do certain things. Another excuse is school and schoolwork. Gotta go to school, gotta get my schoolwork done, got homework. We got all kinds of excuses that we use with school. Sometimes we like to use our family as an excuse. Family's in town, family needs me, gotta be here, gotta be there, can't forsake the family. Another excuse that we like to give is, oh well, I'm just feeling a little bad today. Just woke up and my eyelids hurt a little and I just couldn't make it down there. Another excuse, no excitement down there in that congregation. You go down there and it's just boring and it's dull and there's just no excitement. Everything is lifeless down there. And how about this one? Poor leadership. Those leaders don't know how to lead. They don't know how to make decisions. And the decisions that they make, can you believe those decisions? Here's the one I like: the preaching. Boy, there's many that revolve around the preaching. Oh, he's too hard. Well, he's too soft. He uses too much scripture. He uses too little scripture. He talks about stories. He's too long. He's too short. He yells. He's too light. Folks, you can't please folks. But you see, they like to blame the preaching, don't they? Sometimes they like to blame their hurt feelings. Well, he hurt my feelings. Got on their toes just a little bit too much. Made the lesson a little bit too applicable, and their feelings got hurt. And guess what? Now they use that as an excuse. What about all those hypocrites down there at the church? Don't want to go down there and be around a bunch of hypocrites, individuals who act one way at the church and another way in their lives. Bunch of hypocrites. Here's one, the weather. It's a little too hot. It's a little too cold. Well, preacher, I got up and I looked outside and there was a big dark cloud out there at 2:00. And I made up my mind right then, I'm not going to subject myself to bad weather at 7 tonight. Another excuse individuals like to use, the darkness. Daylight savings time. I'm glad it's about to change. Because you get another hour at night. Because you see, when it gets dark, we just can't do anything. Can't even call somebody to come and pick me up to bring me to worship services. I understand there's individuals can't drive, but folks, darkness, really? But we use it as an excuse. A lack of knowledge. I just don't have the knowledge. Watch this one. A lack of ability. I don't have the ability to do that or this. Another one. A lack of time. I mean, I've only got so much time in the day, and my day is packed already. There's just no way I can do that. Lack of resources. I just don't have the finances. Another excuse that individuals give is their age. I'm too young. I'm too old. Right now, I'm in the prime of life, and I've got to do some other things, but when I get old, guess what? Then I will. All kinds of excuses. How about this one? That church down there just has all kinds of problems down there. They just struggle all the time. They keep trying, they keep trying, they keep trying. But there's just so many problems down there at that church. Another excuse. I don't like someone. How about this one? A lack of gratitude. Well, I do this and I do that for the church and nobody ever tells me thank you for what I've done. How about this one? A lack of participation by other individuals. I go down there to participate, and guess what? It's the same old ones every time down there. Guys, there are 20 excuses on that list right there. And I've heard every one of them as a preacher of the gospel. Every one of them. At some point in individuals' lives, we make excuses as to why we can't do certain things in the kingdom of God. Now, here's something that's interesting. Excuses are not new, are they? You can go all the way back to the very beginning of time and you can find individuals who love to make excuses. You turn into Genesis 3 and Adam has an excuse. God looks at Adam and he asks him a question. Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee, saying, thou shouldest not eat? And Adam said unto God, the woman that thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the fruit thereof, and I did eat. It's not my fault. Excuse me for what I've done, but it's really this woman's fault. And God, if the truth be known, it's your fault because you brought her to me. I didn't ask for it. So God immediately turns to Eve, doesn't he? And he asks her the question, what is this thou hast done? Rather than just saying that I've sinned and I've transgressed against the will of God, she immediately says this. The serpent beguiled me and I did eat. Genesis 3 verse 13. It's not my fault. That a wily serpent tricked me and caused me to eat that fruit. One of the most interesting ones is Moses. You go to Exodus chapter 3 and chapter 4 and Moses is being called by God to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt. Folks, it's something that Moses had desired to do 40 years prior. In addition to that, he sees a burning bush in the wilderness, and guess what? That bush never, ever, ever burns up. I don't know about you. That would convince me of a few things. At least I'd like to think so. But when he's told what his mission was, go back to Pharaoh and you tell him that God says to let his people go. 5 excuses that he gives in those 2 chapters. 5 excuses. The one I have listed, Exodus 4 verse 10, is the very last one. And Moses said unto the Lord, "Oh my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore since thou hast spoken unto me. For I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue." I got to thinking about old Moses. 2 things. Number one, he was pretty quick-tongued with excuses. 1 command, 5 excuses. That's a lot of excuses for 1 command. But yet, what does he say? "No, Lord, I'm of slow tongue." No, you're not. You want to be excused, and you're pretty quick-tongued. Now listen to these words that he speaks. "I am not eloquent, neither heretofore since thou hast spoken unto thy servant." Who talks like that? Folks, the only kind of person who talks like that is an eloquent man. Moses had been trained in the best schools of Egypt. He was a man who was well educated. And he was a man, if he so desired, he had the ability to stand before others and speak. He had to do it when he was second in command in Egypt, did he not? He never complained about that way back then. He knew how to be eloquent in order to get out of duty and responsibility. You talk about the children of Israel, they had their excuses, did they not? God wanted them to go in and conquer that promised land. An individual stood up before them, Joshua and Caleb, and told them, "Yes, we can do this. Yes, it's conquerable. Yes, the Lord will be with us." But the men that went with him said, "We be not able to go against the people, for they are stronger than we." Just can't do it. Why can't we do it? Because they're too strong. They're too great. They're too mighty. Their walls of their city are humongous. They're giants in the land, and we look like little grasshoppers in their sight. There's no way to do that. Just a bunch of excuses. Here's one I like, Elijah. He had his excuse, did he not? God finds Elijah way down south in Beersheba, hiding in a cave. "Elijah, what in the world is going on? Why are you in this cave? Why aren't you out still serving me? Why aren't you out still fulfilling your role and responsibility as a prophet?" And he says this, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, but the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, have torn down thine altars, and have slain all thy prophets." Now watch what he says. "And I, even I alone, am left, and they seek my life to take it." God, I can't be on this mission. I can't do what you're asking me to do. I can't get out there and expose myself. First of all, I'm the only one left. There's not another faithful person in Israel. And if I get out there and I expose myself and I fulfill my role as a prophet, guess what? They're going to take my life. I just can't do this. Wow. A good excuse, wasn't it? Jesus talked about excuses, didn't he? Luke, the 14th chapter, beginning at verse 16, the Bible says that a certain man made a great supper and bade many. And he sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, "Come, for all things are now ready." I don't know about you, I kind of like a good feast, don't you? And especially a feast put on by an extremely wealthy individual. He sends his servant out. Everything's ready, folks. The tables are filled with food. They've made all their preparations. And he came to the first and he said, "I have bought a piece of ground I must needs go and see it. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have both 5 yoke of oxen, and I must go and prove them. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I've married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. Excuses. Bought a piece of land, and he had to go see it. What, he hadn't already seen it before he bought it? Man bought 5 yoke of oxen. He said, I've got to go prove them. You mean you bought those oxen before you proved them? And apparently, whoever this man was that married a wife, he married an ugly woman. He didn't even want to take her with him and show her off. I married a wife. Can't show that woman at that feast. I don't know the reason behind all those excuses, folks. All I know is this. Jesus says they all began to make excuse with one consent as to why they couldn't come. So excuses, our excuses, aren't new. Not to God. Like we said at the very start of the lesson, God has heard them all, hasn't He? Now let's talk about some facts about excuses. And there's a bunch of them that we could talk about. Number one, they are easy to make, aren't they? It's just unbelievable how easy people can make an excuse. I had a hurt in my little toe. That's as good as any, isn't it? Here's the problem with excuses. The second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, they get easier and easier and easier to make, don't they? Here's one that I like. Excuses seem to be legitimate to the person who makes it. See, the person who makes an excuse in his mind doesn't think it's an excuse. That individual thinks that this is a real reason that's acceptable to the Almighty God. I mean, I accept it. It sounds great to me. It took me a long time to come up with it. And it's legitimate to me. See, it's self-deceiving, folks, when we make excuses. Excuses get us out of doing service for the Almighty God. I've never heard a person ever make an excuse to do more for God. You know that? Don't hear that very often, do you? But I hear excuses all the time for individuals not doing things for the Almighty God. Here's another thing about excuses. Excuses ease our conscience, right? Folks, when you and I do something wrong, when you and I don't do something that God asks us to do, we have a conscience that's supposed to bear witness against us. We are supposed to feel guilt. We are supposed to feel shame. We are supposed to be individuals whose conscience will move us to do what is right before God. But you see, I have an excuse. And my excuse alleviates all the feelings of my conscience. It's legitimate, remember? It's a real reason. And so therefore, I don't have to worry about my conscience hurting me anymore. Watch some more facts about excuses. They always allow subpar performance. You know that? Folks, here's what I wish we had in the kingdom. I wish we had congregations filled with people whose mindset was, I'm going to perform for God to the most excellent standard of mine ability. I'm not going to shoot for anything but that which is excellent in the sight of God. The best of the best that I can possibly give God. That's what I'm going to do. But we make excuses, and guess what our excuse does? It keeps me from performing excellency. Subpar performance. Folks, excuses weaken our spiritual lives. People who use excuses, they're not normally the most strong individuals in congregations. Folks, they're the individuals who are weak. They're the individuals who are struggling. They're the individuals who aren't growing in their Christian life. Notice also, That excuses oftentimes lead us directly into sin. Remember, once you give one excuse, it's easier to give a second, a third, a fourth. And folks, before we know it, we are no longer faithful to God. And now we're in sin. Excuses bring failure, don't they? Moses had all those excuses. And folks, if God had accepted those excuses, guess what? The children of Israel would have remained in Egyptian bondage. Excuses bring failure. Here's the biggest concern that I have about excuses is that my excuses hide deeper spiritual problems that individuals have. The excuse is just the surface stuff. It's just the facade on the top. If you could peel off that old excuse and you could get down deep, here's what you would find. You would find that I have a person standing before me who has a lack of love for the Almighty God. I've got an individual who really does not have deep spiritual interest in the things of God. See, it really doesn't interest me. I really don't want to do it anyway. We get down and we peel that old excuse off and we find fear and we find selfishness, don't we? I don't want to do that. I don't want to sacrifice. I don't want to get out of my comfort zone. I don't want to have to change. I don't want to have to mold myself into something different than I am. Do you hear all the I's? It's all about selfishness, folks. Some facts about excuses. If you don't remember anything else, you remember this point in this lesson when you begin to make an excuse. God's reaction to the excuses of man. Just a moment ago, we talked about Moses, did we not? He made that fifth excuse. I am not eloquent, Lord. Slow of speech, got a slow tongue. That was the fifth excuse he had made. And folks, notice what the very next verse says. Exodus 4 verse 11. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses. God's fed up. Folks, if there's anybody that we don't want to get angry, guess what? It's God Almighty. You don't want God angry with. And yet we make excuse after excuse after excuse after excuse as to why we can't do things. As to why we need to be alleviated from our obligations and our duties and our responsibilities. And God sits upon His throne and He looks down upon us. And folks, guess what? It angers the Lord. What is He talking about? What is she saying? You remember those individuals who wanted to be released from the obligation of going to the feast? We have the reaction of the Lord in that particular text. So that servant came and told him all these things. Now notice what it says. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant. Folks, that master is Jesus Christ. He's the one who's prepared the feast. He's the one who's issued forth the great invitation. And all of a sudden, everybody's making excuses as to why they can't be there. And when he hears their excuses, guess what? He's angered by what he hears. I was thinking about this as I was sitting over on the seat just a moment ago. Folks, this isn't something that I'm trying to make up. There's a God who's out there. There's a God who resides in heaven. And He really is concerned about us and our spiritual condition. And He really is aware of everything that's going on as far as our lives are concerned as Christians. And we go back to these stories like Moses, and we go back to this story that Jesus told during His ministry, and we hear the reaction of God, and then we have a tendency to just dismiss it as if that's way past there, or it's just a story that's made up, and that's not the truth, folks. things. I'm trying to talk about right now. And I'm trying to talk about God's reaction right now toward our excuses. Those weren't the only reactions God had. Oh, Adam, I'm sorry I made the woman. I'll just kill her and bring you another one. Oh, you're right, Eve. That old serpent is a pretty bad individual. I'll just deal with him and not you. Folks, that wasn't God's reaction. He didn't accept either one of those excuses from either one of those two of His first creation. And He punished them both, didn't He? You remember old Elijah, don't you? I and I alone am left here in Israel. Folks, God didn't accept that excuse. God didn't say, well, Elijah, you know, you're absolutely right. Why don't I just miraculously transport you to Egypt and you can just get away from all of this stuff? Elijah's thinking was sick. Elijah's thinking was corrupt. Elijah's thinking was wrong, folks. And in verse 18, guess what? God tells Elijah, I have 7,000 who have not yet bowed the knee to Baal in Israel. Elijah, you are not the only one. I've got a huge group of faithful, dedicated followers still in Israel. You are not the only person, and I refuse to accept your excuse. The man who invited those guests to the feasts, oh, I tell you what, I realize that wives can be a burden. Yes, he really does need to go check on those 10 oxen. Yes, new land, that's pretty important. I tell you what, servants, let's just pack it all up, throw it in the freezer, and we'll try again next week. Go read that text again, folks. That's not what that master does. That master turns that servant around and he sends him out into the highways and the byways and the hedges. And he invites in all kinds of individuals. The house is still not full. He sends him back out again. And then I want you to listen to what the master says. For I say unto you, none of those men that were bidden shall taste of my feast. Folks, that person who says that is Jesus Christ. He's the master in this particular story. You don't want what I have to offer? Fine. You want to make an excuse? Fine. There's other individuals out there who I can invite. There's others out there that I can use. And guess what? Because of your decision, you shall never taste of my feast. Folks, those are strong words, aren't they? We've got to overcome our excuses. Very quickly, let me give you some helps as to how you can do that. Number one, we need to admit that we make excuses. Just need to admit it. And we all have done it, haven't we? The Bible says in Proverbs 28, verse 13, whoso covereth his sins, guess what? He shall not prosper. But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. All God's asking us to do is come to Him and say, God, you know what? I've made tons of excuses as to why I'm not faithful. I've made tons of excuses as to why I haven't grown. I've made tons of excuses why I have not been dedicated to Your cause. And I want to be forgiven of that. That's all He asks. Just confess them and you'll get mercy. Secondly, folks, what we need to do is replace our excuses with positive affirmations, don't we? That's exactly what Elijah was given by God. I and I alone am left. And God says, oh no, here's what you need to say. There are 7,000 in Israel who have not yet bowed the knee to Baal. Folks, that's a positive affirmation. I don't know how to do this. I don't have the ability to do this. So I think I'll just let somebody else do that. No, folks, that's not what you say. I don't know right now. I don't have all the ability that I need right now. But guess what? You give me somebody to show me. You give somebody to teach me. And guess what? I'll be happy to do it. That's the attitude. Well, preacher, we've tried and we failed down there before. Can't do all that. Folks, that's not what we need to say. Yes, we've tried and failed in the past, but here's what we need to say. We can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth us. That's the positive affirmation. Folks, all this negative stuff, we've got to get rid of that mess. And we've got to make positive affirmations as to why things can be done and why we can do those things, rather than excuses as to why they can't be done. Right now, today, we need to take positive action, don't we? All of those things that we said can't be done, all of those things we don't want to do, all of those things that we've tried to get ourselves excused from, guess what? It's time today to start doing some of those things. I've never taught a class, but guess what? I think I will today. It's been about 30 years since I've been to a Sunday night service. We're going to have one tonight. Why not today? Just come on back tonight. Folks, what I'm saying is this. Confess the sin. Repent of it. Bring forth fruits unto the Almighty God, showing that you've changed. And guess what? That's all God asks, isn't it? That's all God asks. Here's another one. Commit to spiritual growth. Peter writes in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Folks, commit to your spiritual growth. I will not be where I am today, tomorrow. Next year, I will not be where I am today because I am going to grow as a Christian. Commit to that. Make certain that spiritual things are important in your life. Here's the biggest problem we have, folks, right here. You know what? There's too many other things in our world that are more important to us than the things of Christ. If ye then be risen, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Folks, if I've been risen with Jesus Christ, if I came forth from the waters of baptism, guess what He asked me to do? Seek those things that are above. Get my priorities straight. And lastly, folks, make up our mind. Resolve that I'm going to obey God. And being made perfect, He became the author of eternal salvation. We love that part, don't we? We want Him as our Savior. We want Him to save us eternally. But notice what the text says. He became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey Him. That's the key. We're at the conclusion. Some of you are saying, "Woo, thank the Lord." Got three quotes that I want to close with about excuses. The first one comes from Benjamin Franklin. Notice what he says. He that is good at making excuses is seldom good for anything else. See, I'm glad Benjamin Franklin said that, not me. Because you can just go talk to Ben about that. Watch this next one. Maturity is when you stop complaining, stop making excuses, and guess what? You start making changes. That's what we tell our kids, isn't it? "I don't know how to make the bed, Mama." Grow up, boy. You're 23 years old. It's time to make a bed. You see, there comes a time when a person has to mature. You know, we can't keep making childish excuses. God isn't going to accept that, folks. We've got to make the change. Watch this next one. When you were busy making all of those excuses, there was somebody out there busy making an enterprise, folks. You know that? Sometimes I look at myself and I say, you know, I just don't have time to write a book. And guess what? I've got friends that are as busy as I am, and they wrote 3 books last year. You see, while I was busy making an excuse as to why I can't do it, there was another friend of mine making the sacrifices, doing the things necessary to produce what needs to be produced. Where did he get all that time? You see, while I'm busy making excuses, others out there building an enterprise. My friends, it's time for us to resolve that we're going to give up all of our excuses. Have you been making those in your spiritual life? Do you need to ask God to forgive you? Dear Christian, what's the excuse that you have for not obeying the gospel of Jesus Christ? What's the excuse? You know what to do to be saved. You've heard the gospel. You know that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. You know that you have sins that you need to turn and change from, repent of. It's not a matter of whether or not you believe that Jesus is the Christ and would make that confession, because if somebody asks you, you say, oh yes, I know Jesus is the Son of God. What's keeping you from being immersed in water for the remission of sins? You know to do that. Jesus said to do it. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Mark 16, verse 16. Can you imagine standing before God, never having done that, and God looks at you and He says, what's your excuse? Folks, there's no excuse that God will look at you and just say, oh, what a wonderful excuse for you not to obey the gospel. Don't do that this morning. Do you need to obey? Won't you come as together we stand and sing?